Welcome to the RNL Revolution Nothing Less show. This is our 175th episode on November 23rd, 2023. My name is Andy Zee. I'm the host of the show, coming to you from Los Angeles, California. Today is Thanksgiving, and this is our special Thanksgiving show, but that doesn't mean that this isn't still a show about and for an actual revolution to overthrow this capitalist imperialist system and bring about a far better world through that revolution for the emancipation of all humanity. And I'm here with Sunsara Taylor.
Hi, I'm the co-host of the Revolution Nothing Less show, back from Chicago. I'll talk about that in a moment. And as Andy said, this is our special Thanksgiving episode, dropping on Thanksgiving. And so we want to send a special greeting to everybody who is making this show part of your holiday gatherings. And we intend to help you mark this holiday in the most appropriate way possible. Later in the episode, we are going to share two American crime short films exposing the real history of conquest and genocide of this country, what it is founded on. We are also going to take a look at a contemporary genocide happening right now in Gaza, carried out by Israel, backed by the U.S. And in particular, we're going to expose the Dark Ages biblical mythology that's being marshaled by the Israeli by Israel and its assault on Gaza. And most importantly, in this episode, we are going to bring you, as we do every week, a vision of the future that this revolution is fighting to make real. We are going to bring this to you through the interviews with Bob Avakian, the leader who has re-envisioned revolution and communism for the world today, the leader we promote and follow on this show. And we are going to share an excerpt of the interviews that Andy and I did with him, where he speaks about the importance of the poetic spirit. So, as I said, I'm back from Chicago, and I know you are on your way to New York, and you should tell our audience why and what this has to do with the interviews I was just talking about.
Yeah, I'm going to be in New York City for the screening of the special one-hour film, Selections from the Bob Avakian Interviews on the RNL show. This is going to be the third big screen showing that I will experience of the film that's been adapted from the three interviews that you and I did with Bob Avakian over a year ago. If you are in traveling distance of New York City, if you're in New York, you need to experience this leader up close. He speaks from the heart and the head with a passion and a scientific unpeeling of why the world doesn't have to be the way it is. From my first two experiences, first in Los Angeles and then in Oakland, California, even having played a key role in the editing of this special film, each time seeing it on the big screen, I was moved. And I'm also going to say that the audience was transformed, including people who had watched the interviews before. What accounts for this? Bob Avakian is a leader who lives and breathes that a far better way of organizing society is possible. And with Bob Avakian, this is not just a desire, not just an aspiration with no way to make it real. But Bob Avakian is a leader who can break down for an audience, whether you have a PhD or you're somebody who never had a chance to finish school due to the conditions of your life. He breaks down why the world is the way it is, why life for billions of people in the world today is a living hell, and why for millions, their lives are being shattered and snuffed out by high-tech weapons made in the USA, in the Ukraine, and in Palestine, all this unleashed by rulers who seek to advance their imperialist empires. And at the same time, why so many people feel that their lives are getting worse. They're desperate, they're depressed, and they see the world heading towards disaster. BA makes people see and feel not just the paltriness of trying to reform the system of capitalism, imperialism that we live under with all these outrageous and utterly gut-wrenching crimes against humanity, but makes people see the absurdity and the impossibility of reforming it. No, we're not going to beg. We're not going to vote. We're not going to boycott this system into being fair and just. It can't be done. This system needs to be overthrown, and Bob Avakian makes it clear why. Bob Avakian is a leader for whom a better world is not just a dream, but realizable, doable. Dig into his work, experience these interviews, and you will see how there is the basis to have a radically new society based on the Constitution for a new socialist republic in North America, which he wrote. Yes, he wrote a constitution for how we could live at long last as human beings. Do you have any idea how big a deal that is? People say, well, what about other leaders? Well, who else has written a blueprint for a whole new, other emancipating way humanity could be living? And what is even more to the point, the Constitution for a new socialist republic written by, yes, this leader, develops a whole legal framework in a new society that enables the masses of people to become leaders, to become masters of society themselves. BA's vision and plan is a way for people to collectively know and change the world to overcome all the forms of oppression and exploitation that people suffer and die under in this capitalist imperialist system that we live under. And I am so bored and so fucking over people saying, I don't want to follow one leader, let alone an older white man, when they are being led like sheep to accept the world the way it is, at best trying to carve out a little space for themselves. And all the more, this makes me furious when they haven't even experienced, checked out, or read this path-breaking work that Bob Avakian has done. What you're going to experience watching the BA interviews is not just a leader who shows why this system is the cause of all that oppresses people today, why this system is leading to the destruction of the environment, why it is unbelievably careening toward world war and nuclear war, why it cannot be reformed. No, BA has not only developed a vision and blueprint for a new society, he has not left us hanging without a way to get to that new society. He's developed a way, a roadmap out right now, to go to work building up the forces for revolution, and then a strategy for actually waging that revolution with a real chance to win. That's a big deal. This is what makes your being at the Clemente Center next Tuesday on the Lower East Side of New York so important, experiencing all of this on the big screen, with a chance for us to talk, with a chance for you to ask me your hardest questions. Look, this may be surprising to you, but Bob Avakian has analyzed that the possibility opening up for a real revolution in this country is not far off. The conditions for revolution are maturing in this country due to the deep divide among the rulers of this country between the fascist Republican Party of Trump and the business-as-usual war criminal party of Biden, the Democrats. But to find out why this is such a rare moment, when revolution could really be possible, you need to be there. It's in the selections from the Bob Avakian Interviews film that we're going to be showing. And more to the point, right now, this rare time can only be seized with more and more people, like you, getting with this revolution, getting into Bob Avakian. And there's no better time or place than next week in New York City. Let me put this simply. Since I'm going to be in the land of elevators, this is what they call an elevator pitch. If you haven't experienced Bob Avakian, you don't know what you need to know. More fundamentally, this isn't just about you. It's about whether or not all the suffering in the world will go on and on. It's about whether or not there will even be a future with the destruction of the climate and the danger of nuclear war. It's about whether or not we can prepare and organize thousands of people for the time that could come soon when we could really make a revolution to emancipate all of humanity. That's what people need to know, and they can't know it without being there. We recently published on our website, revcom.us, an important guide to getting prepared for a revolution titled Revolution. Building up the basis to go for the whole thing with a real chance to win, strategic orientation and practical approach is part of 10 points that we can carry out. And I say we, meaning all of you as well as the RevComs. It speaks in one of those points, point three, to the role Bob Avakian plays and why he's so important. It says this, it says, quote, Bob Avakian is completely different than the endless stream of bourgeois capitalist leaders who are put forward and others who cannot see or will not look beyond the confines of this horrific system. He is hardcore for revolution, with a largeness of mind and generosity of spirit and a lively sense of humor. A leader like this has never before existed in the history of this country, and having a leader like this is a rare and a precious thing for the masses of people who are so terribly oppressed under this system. It is a powerful, positive factor for the revolution that is urgently needed, with the goal of ending all oppression and finally bringing about the emancipation of humanity as a whole, end quote. And this is what you get in the special film, Selections from the Bob Avakian Interviews on the RNL Show. Now, before the Los Angeles screenings, Sunsara, you and I did a special program on this film. And in that, you went into what the situation is and why this
The moment we're in that makes this even more important.
Right. Yeah. So I want to show that now, and then we'll take it from there. You can take it from there. I want to show people the public service announcements that some of our good friends have done.
We're living in absolutely crazy, dangerous times. We face climate destruction. We face the very direct threat of all-out fascism being imposed in this country through the 2024 elections, if not sooner.
And we will make America great again. Thank you.
We face the escalating threat of nuclear war between the U.S. and Russia or China. And now we see this absolutely heartrending conflagration in Israel and Gaza, which is worsening by the day, with 2 million people in Gaza deprived of food, medicine, water, electricity, and way too many people on both sides lusting for bloodlust and revenge instead of revolution and real emancipation. Times like this demand a revolutionary answer. It is time to come together in person, live, in the theater, to engage Bob Avakian, who's forged a way out of this madness, developed a new communism, a whole new framework for human emancipation, and brings it alive with heart and soul. So we want to invite you to come out.
We can no longer afford to allow these imperialists to dominate the world and to determine the destiny of humanity. They need to be overthrown as quickly as possible.
In these interviews, Bob Avakian brings alive the strategy for revolution, the science of how we understand and change the world. He brings alive the vision of the future that's possible, and he opens up in a way you've never seen him before, unless you've been watching our show, but you've never seen it on the big screen together with others like this. He bears his heart and his soul, and he opens up about what formed him, his hopes, and he struggles hard with the people who need to be part of this revolution to break with all the ways this system has them beaten down, going along, turned against each other, despairing. And he struggles to lift their sights and win them to this revolution and to be filled with the same scientific daring that he is.
Look, nobody wants to live the way these youth are being forced to live. Don't tell me you don't care, because I know different and I know better.
We also want to share with you two of the powerful PSAs we have posted at our website, revcom.us. People from different perspectives speaking on why these interviews with Bob Avakian are so important to them and so necessary to be seen by many more. So we want to share these with you and urge you to share them with others. The first is from Arturo O'Farrill, who is a Grammy Award-winning Afro-Latin jazz musician, an incredible person, a musician and teacher. And that will be followed by David Zeiger, who is an award-winning documentary filmmaker. He's also a contributor to the Revolution Nothing Less show. We'll be featuring his American Crimes later in today's episode. Let's watch.
This is a very, very scary time that we live in. Images are coming at us from all kinds of sources that tell us that the demonization of a people is the problem, that we're looking at people and we're confusing the terrible things that are happening with humanity. But it's not. It's not humanity that's at fault. It's the ruling class. It's the incredible, greedy, selfish, gluttonous, predatory capitalists that are destroying life on Earth. Look outside your window. What is happening to the climate? Who are we demonizing to blame? We can't escape the fact that it is global capitalism that is destroying, life. We must listen to Bob Avakian as he explains to us scientifically why these things are happening and how we can help be a part of a revolution that can change. If you really look at the world right now, we're on the verge of neo-fascism and a global capitalist predatory staging of a war on the poor the war on the poor who were predominantly black and brown. It's time to stand up, take our lives back, and demand that the change is real and permanent and that it's part of a revolution. You must see the Bob Avakian interviews on October 17th at the Hudson Theater, and just check him out, man. It's not like the revolutionary you think who's screaming and yelling. And no, man, this guy's approachable. He's clear. He's direct. He speaks right to you. And he is very convincing about the truths that we must all hear, hard truths that we must all see, face, and realize. It's not getting better. It's not getting better. It's getting worse. Read the newspapers, watch the news shows, just keep track of things. They're lying to us on a daily basis, and it's horrifying. CNN, Fox, the same thing. It's the same thing. Red state, blue state, two-party system, no-party system. It's all about capitalism. It's all about the destruction of the working class. So please, we must fight this thing. We must educate ourselves. We must listen to Bob Avakian as he teaches us about these truths.
Hi, I'm David Zeiger. I am a documentary filmmaker. I made the film Sir, No Sir. And I want to speak just for a minute here to my fellow skeptics. You know, maybe you hate capitalism. You know that capitalism is really the source of all of the ills that we're facing in the world, especially climate change. I know there's a lot of folks out there that at least have some real understanding or some beginning understanding that capitalism is the problem. But can anything be done about it? Can we do anything other than elections? After all, revolutions have been tried in the past, and ultimately, at least for what it looks like now, they have turned into something that you wouldn't want to live in. But you know that you've got to do something. You know that this world is in very big danger. Well, I'd like you to bring all of that skepticism with you and come hear what Bob Avakian has to say. This is not just a matter of someone else's opinion. This is someone who, from a position deep in his heart, of hatred for what this society, what this country, what this system has done to humanity and the world, has fought over and over again to find the new ways to approach the question of revolution. Can it happen in this country? Bring those questions with you and pay close attention to what Bob Avakian has to say. You're not going to regret it. I think you're going to learn a lot, and it may change your life, and I hope it does.
So once again, take those words to heart. Be in the theater next Tuesday night if you can get to New York. Andy spoke about the importance of Bob Avakian and why you need to see him together with others. You just heard me speak about the moment that we're in, and then David and Arturo speak about the importance of this. I want to just say the last thing before I move forward is that it's a big deal that Andy Zee, the host of our show, will be in the house to take your questions, to be in discussion with you afterwards. He was able to sit down with Bob Avakian. He's going to be live and in person. Do not miss the opportunity to experience that as well. And with that, I want to move forward and say that today we have selected a special portion of these interviews to share with you on this Thanksgiving episode. This is from the end of the first interview that we did with Bob Avakian, where Andy asks him about why he's put such stress on the danger of leading a Marxist or a communist revolution if you don't have a poetic spirit, why you need this. And this comes after Bob Avakian has spoken about his own life, somehow he went from a patriotic, all-American kid to somebody who is the most ardent critic of everything that America stands for, and more than a critic, somebody who's envisioned a world beyond America and everything it stands for, how he made this transformation. He just has spoken about what an actual revolution is. He's gotten into the strategy for this revolution. He's gotten into what it means to be scientific and why that matters so much. He's gotten into why we're in a time that is when it is more possible to make this revolution. He's got covered quite a bit at this point in the interview, and then Andy asked him to step back because he's covered quite a bit at this point in the interview. And then Andy asked him, because a lot of people will not put these things together, hardcore for revolution, which Bob Avakian definitely is, but where does the poetic spirit fit into that? It's not the typical stereotype of a communist. Let's watch.
I've already taken us to what we wanted to end the first interview with you on the show, and by singing, I think, at least three times on this show, which has been great, because what we wanted to do is in 2003, you gave a talk that we call the Revolution Talk, and I don't know, hours into it, all of a sudden you burst into song, a Ry Cooter song, Across the Borderline.
Now, my voice is hoarse, but I'm going to give this a try. There's a land, so I've been told.
And then later on, decade later, I guess the band Outer National took that and put it into a song that we've played many times on the show.
There's a land, so I've been told. Every street is paved with gold, and it's just across the borderline.
And then you've also spoken, see, you've taken a lot of things out from what we said. So I just want to make sure everybody sees this. We were just talking before about these are 45 records. Yeah. Okay. Vinyl's not coming back in this form. But look, this is your memoir, From Ike to Mal and Beyond, My Journey from Mainstream America to Revolutionary Communist. But there you are with the record. So, and you just spoke about the influence of the culture, black culture. But we wanted to ask you about this, because you've written and talked about how if you don't have a poetic spirit, or at least a poetic side, it's very dangerous for you to lead a Marxist movement or be the leader of a socialist state. This question of the poetic side, and you've written about, including to people of our, who've not had a formal education, the importance of Shakespeare and how you can understand that. You've spoken some already tonight about the influence of black music on you, but poetry, literature, these are things that have had a big influence on you. So we wanted to ask you two things. One, how did this shape you, who you are? And then more, why does it matter to have a poetic spirit to lead a revolution?
Well, you see, you held up that memoir cover, and you see that tells you what, at the time, I thought looked cool. So you can draw your own conclusions about that. What does it reflect about the times, and perhaps about me at the time, too? But
you missed a whole discussion here last night about the Beach Boys, and then what happened in the move to black culture and all the developments. But
well, I'm sorry, I missed it. Sounds interesting. But to get to your question, look, I think human beings need. This is a point that's been made, but it's important to keep coming back to this. Human beings need to be amazed. That's part of what it means to be human. You know, you get amazed when you see an amazing painting or a cultural performance or something someone does in athletics. You know, and you get a certain joy from being amazed at some, especially in a positive way. And this is one element of it. But more generally, human beings have a need for beauty. And beauty comes in many different forms. It comes in nature. And yes, different people do find different things beautiful, but still there's a need for beauty. It comes in nature, it comes in music, it comes in poetry, it comes in literature generally. You know, it comes in many different forms. You know, a sunset and so on and so forth. If the kind of world we're aiming for is not one where that kind of beauty is discounted or, suppressed, but one where the human being's need for that is given much fuller expression. And a lot of that is suppressed in people. You know, life is so hard for so many people, and things are so bitter that they don't, you know, and they're scuffling so hard, they don't even have the chance to enjoy much beauty, although they do find ways even so. So, you know, the kind of world we're aiming for is a world where the human ability to, you know, appreciate beauty in many different forms would be given much fuller expression. And that links up with the question, you know, there's also beauty in the intellectual realm. Look at this, telescope and what it's showing us about the universe. There's beauty in that. There's wonder in that. You know, isn't that important for human beings to have a full life? You know, and you know, the same when you're you know, trying to solve a problem, not just a political problem, but you know, trying to understand a phenomenon in nature, and then you finally do understand it. It's a very exhilarating experience. The same is true in literature. Like, you know, you mentioned Shakespeare. Well, you know, a lot of Shakespeare language is archaic. It means it's outdated. It means language that people all would have understood generally at the time, but not all of it, not even most of it. But some of it is language that we no longer use. You know, most people don't go around saying forsooth and so on and so forth, you know. And there are other expressions that are even, you know, more abstract to people, or, you know, unfamiliar to people now. But there's a lot of beauty in the language of Shakespeare. And let's be clear. There are a lot of dead people who are not white who have also created a lot of beauty in the world, and too much of that has been suppressed. But there are also dead white men who have created a lot of beauty, and we should not be prevented from enjoying that as well. And Shakespeare is one of them. The language is beautiful. You know, I as I said in my memoir, I enjoy puns. There are all kinds of puns in Shakespeare. Some of them are better than others. But, you know, there are all kinds of humor. You know, there's even malapropisms, which means, you know, misusing or, you know, a word, saying a word wrong, or, I remember one, I think it's in Macbeth, the play Macbeth, which, by the way, was a favorite of Huey Newton. He used to quote, Act 5, Scene 5, Macbeth, tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow creeps in its petty pace from day to day, etc. You know, but earlier in there, there's a scene where there's this drunken gatekeeper at one of the castles, and he opens the gate and he starts rambling on and on. And at one point he says, comparisons are odorous. Now it's actually supposed to be comparisons are odious. Odious means hateful. But he's drunk and he does a malapropism. He says, but after all, comparisons are odorous, means they stink, you know. So, you know, even things like that are, you know, I get a kick out of it. You know, it's funny. You know, it's a good use of a malapropism. You know, it's a good use of language, you know, and distorting language for the purpose of humor. You know, and different people like different poets, you know, modern poetry from the Romantic period. You know, I happen to like Keats as I was growing up. I found the language very evocative. You know, it made me think about a lot of things, and it also just it created a certain feeling beyond just what it made me think about. Created a certain feeling, you know. Bright star, were I as steadfast as thou art. You know, just looking at a star and saying, okay, this star is, you know, seems to have a lot of constancy. It's there all the time. You know, would that I could be as firm as that. You know, just, you know, things like that. That, you know, make you think, make you feel. If you don't have an appreciation for that, then when you turn to politics, you're going to tend to be very dogmatic. And you're going to be very dry. And nobody's going to live in any kind of world that you have anything to do with setting the terms of. At least I certainly wouldn't. And I don't think most people would. So this is what I mean when I say, you know, you don't have to write poetry. That's not my point. But, you know, you have to have an appreciation for beauty in all these different kinds of ways, or else you're not aiming for the kind of society that we need to be aiming for, where human beings can really thrive in the fullest way and in the fullest dimensions.
When the State of Israel was founded in 1948, the lie was propagated that this was a land without a people for a people without a land, and that God had promised this land to the Jewish people long ago. Now, in a second, we will crack open this Bible and expose the absolute horror show behind that scriptural claim. But first, let's be clear. In reality, there already were people living in the land that is now Israel. Almost 2 million Palestinians. So what did the Zionist founders of Israel do? Between 1947 and 1949, these Zionists unleashed a massive campaign of terror and mass expulsions. They drove at least 750,000 Palestinians from their homes. They carried out over 70 massacres. They destroyed over 500 Palestinian villages. These Zionists literally built their homes and their new state of Israel on the ashes of these ruins. And all of this, and all the ongoing violence and expansion, the unjust wars, and now the outright genocide being inflicted on the people of Gaza, and the killings and torture that is running wild in the West Bank, has been backed and enabled by Israel's imperialist masters, most of all today, the United States. But what about the claim that the Zionists put forth that according to scripture, this land rightfully belongs to the Jewish people, as it was supposedly promised to them by God?
Israeli Prime Minister David Ben-Gurion often said that the Bible was the Jewish mandate for settling the land of Israel. In the book of Genesis, God gave the land to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the patriarchs of Israel. And the rest of the Bible tells the story of their descendants in the land.
Well, the truth is that when the founders of Zionism set out looking for a place to erect their Jewish supremacist state, they considered setting it up in many different parts of the world, not just in Palestine. They looked at Paraguay. They looked at South Africa. So this wasn't really about this historic biblical claim. And they openly pitched their new state to the European powers as a colonial project. In other words, they made clear that they'd act as enforcers of imperialist domination wherever they set up. But there is another problem with this so-called scriptural historical claim to the land of Palestine. A reason why the Zionists who claim this should really be hoping that no one looks too closely into it. And that is this. If you look at the Old Testament of the Bible, much of which corresponds to Jewish scripture, it is clear that in the territory that according to this scripture had been promised by God to the ancient Israelites, there were already other people living there then as well. The book of Joshua tells the story of one of Moses' generals leading the Israelites to cross the Jordan River and steal the lands and slaughter all the people who lived in that area, which is now Palestine.
Joshua. Huh? Who? Who is that?
It's me, Joshua.
God?
I have chosen you, Joshua, to lead the Israelites to the Promised Land.
This conquest includes the Battle of Jericho. Now, if you're like me, you learned this story in Sunday school and you sang the song, Joshua fought the Battle of Jericho, Jericho, Jericho.
Joshua fought the Battle of Jericho, Jericho, Jericho. Joshua fought the Battle of Jericho, and the walls came a-tumbling down.
But do you know what the Israelites did once the walls of Jericho allegedly tumbled down? According to Joshua, chapter 6, verse 21, after the wall collapsed, the Israelites charged into the city and, quote, they devoted all in the city to destruction, both men and women, young and old, oxen, sheep, and donkeys, with the edge of the sword. And after bringing out the prostitute Rahab, who had betrayed the city and helped the Israelites, as well as her family, the Bible goes on in Joshua 10:24 to say this, quote, then the Israelites burned the whole city and everything in it. They put the silver and the gold and the articles of bronze and iron into the treasury of the Lord's house. And that was just one of the cities the Israelites utterly destroyed, according to scripture. And the 10th chapter of Joshua alone there is the slaughter of every inhabitant of the Makeda, then the Libna, then Lachish, then Eglon, then Hebron, then Debir, and city after city beyond that. At each point, the Bible spells out, so there can be no confusion, that this was genocidal slaughter, and describing the destruction of Negev and the whole region from Kadesh Barnea to Gaza and from Goshen to Gibeon, the Bible is very specific. Quote, Joshua subdued the whole region. He left no survivors. He totally destroyed all who breathed. At other points, the Israelites called out every one of their soldiers to individually stomp on the neck of the kings they had conquered. And then they impaled these kings' bodies and left them on spikes. And when there was a soldier who betrayed Joshua's command, he, Achan, is brought out before all the people of Israel and stoned to death as an example and a warning to all the others. Now, all of this is what the Lord of the Bible is commanding and celebrating. And all of this is what the Zionist upholders of the state of Israel are resting their so-called spiritual claim to Palestine upon. And finally, after all of this, and much more slaughter that goes on, bloody page after bloody page, there is Joshua 24:13, describing what the Lord allegedly said to the Israelites upon their victory. Quote, So I gave you a land on which you did not toil, and cities you did not build, and you live in them and eat from vineyards and olive groves that you did not plant. End quote. To the degree that any of this reflects actual history, the parallels with the modern situation of Palestine and Israel are in fact quite striking and damning. Now, the rest of this Bible is also bloodthirsty and filled with ignorance and reactionary moral codes, not just the Old Testament, which parallels the Jewish scripture, but also the New Testament, which many Christians claim supersedes the Old Testament. But this book as a whole, which consists to a large degree of made-up things and distortions of actual history, is never a source that should be relied on as the basis for claims and demands. And the same can be said of the scriptures of every religion. And certainly, in this case in particular, this scriptural history is not something that the Zionists should really want to invoke.
On this day in 1767, Andrew Jackson was born on the backwoods soil of the Carolinas. From poverty and obscurity, Jackson rose to glory and greatness, first as a military leader and then as the seventh president of the United States. He did it with courage, with grit, and with patriotic heart. And by the way, he was one of our great presidents.
In 1814, we took a little trip along with Colonel Jackson down the mighty Mississippi.
Andrew Jackson, war hero, slaver, virulent racist, and the seventh president of the United States. One of his more notable feats as a general was the slaughter of 186 Creek Indians during the Red Stick War of 1813. "We shot them like dogs," crowed his buddy Davy Crockett. When Creek women began desperately killing their own children to keep them from being butchered by the soldiers, the brave Indian fighter Andrew Jackson grabbed a baby from his mother's arms, took him home, and gave him to his wife to raise as their own. He then forced the Creeks to cede 21 million acres of land to the United States. But the pinnacle of his fame rests on the Indian Removal Act of 1830. In the face of multiple attacks on Native homelands from state militias, the Supreme Court had ruled that Native American tribes were sovereign nations, protected against being illegally forced off their land. President Jackson's response, quote, "The Supreme Court has made their decision, now let them enforce it," end quote. nothing was going to stand in the way of his view that it was the divine right of the white population to rid the country of the more than three dozen tribes whose ancestral land stood in the way of the booming slavery-driven economy of the South and the country as a whole. Here's what he said in his 1833 State of the Union address, quote, "Indians have neither the intelligence, the industry, the moral habits, nor the desire of improvement, which are essential to any favorable change in their condition. Established in the midst of another and superior race, they must necessarily yield to the force of circumstances, and ere before long disappear." End quote. True to his word, from 1814 to 1824, Jackson was instrumental in negotiating 9 out of 11 treaties, which forced the southeastern tribes to give up their native lands in exchange for lands in the western territory of Oklahoma. The law required the government to negotiate removal treaties fairly, voluntarily, and peacefully. It did not permit the president or anyone else to coerce native nations into giving up their land. But President Jackson and his government weren't going to let petty details like that get in their way. And in the winter of 1831, under the threat of invasion by the U.S. Army, the Choctaw became the first nation to be expelled from its land altogether. They made the journey to Indian Territory on foot, some bound in chains and marched double file, one historian writes, and without any food, supplies, or other help from the government, thousands of people died along the way. It was, as one Choctaw leader told an Alabama newspaper, a trail of tears and death. Over the next 10 years, the Trail of Tears wove a web of terror across the United States. In 1836, 15,000 Creeks were driven from their land. 3,500 died on the brutal trek. In 1835, the government signed a removal treaty with a self-appointed illegal group of Cherokee. But in 1838, only about 2,000 Cherokees had left their Georgia homeland for Indian Territory. So then President Martin Van Buren sent General Winfield Scott and 7,000 soldiers to, quote, expedite the removal process, end quote. Scott and his troops forced the Cherokee into stockades at Bayonet Point, while whites looted their homes and belongings. Then they marched the Indians more than 1,200 miles to Oklahoma. Whooping cough, typhus, dysentery, cholera, and starvation were epidemic along the way, and historians estimate that more than 5,000 Cherokee died on that journey. President Van Buren then summed up the campaign in this message to Congress, quote, "It affords me sincere pleasure to be able to apprise you of the entire removal of the Cherokee Nation of Indians to their new homes west of the Mississippi. The measures authorized by Congress with a view to the long-standing controversy with them have had the happiest effect, and they have emigrated without any apparent resistance." By 1840, an estimated 60,000 Native Americans had been driven off of their land in the southeastern United States and forced to move across the Mississippi to Indian Territory. As many as 16,000 died along the route. The federal government promised that their new land would remain unmolested forever, but as the line of white settlement pushed forward, Indian country shrank and shrank. By 1907, Oklahoma became a state, and Indian Territory was gone for good.
This is a song that the Cherokee mothers sang on the Trail of Tears to their children, who, after seeing such horrors as happened on the trail, were told to remember the beautiful things that they also saw. The beautiful clouds forming animals, the dancing grass, the beautiful colors of the trout, and the beautiful songs of the birds.
How do you commit genocide? There's the old-fashioned way, outright slaughter. And when it comes to Native Americans, nobody beats the expanding countries of the United States and Canada. Credible estimates of the indigenous population in North America in 1492 are between 12.5 and 18.5 million. Through the combination of massive epidemics and the Indian wars waged by the U.S. Army,
through the decades after the Civil War. By 1890, the estimated Native American population had been reduced to fewer than 240,000 in the U.S., and in Canada, a third of that, a population reduction of 95 to 99%. But what about the remaining 1 to 5%? You can't just allow them to rebuild their decimated communities and reverse all your hard work, can you? Enter Colonel Richard Pratt, intrepid Indian fighter and former head of the Fort Marion Military Prison for Apache prisoners, who in 1892 declared, "A great general, Philip Sheridan, has said that the only good Indian is a dead one. In a sense, I agree with that sentiment, but only in this, that all the Indian there is in the race should be dead. Kill the Indian in him and save the man." In other words, assimilate the survivors. Educate them to become suitable to be members of the society that had devastated and despised them. So in the 1860s, religious orders began setting up schools on reservations aiming to convert the children to Christianity. But the U.S. Indian Commission concluded that assimilation could not be successful as long as the children still lived at home and returned to their families at the end of each day. The answer? Remove the children. So from the 1870s to the mid-20th century, U.S. policy decreed that every Native American child would be taken from his or her home, family, community, and culture, beginning as early as 5 years of age, and sent to off-reservation boarding schools where they were to remain for up to a decade in state-sponsored educational facilities. As many as 500 Indian boarding schools in the U.S., 153 Indian boarding schools, and many more religious schools run by Christian denominations and paid for by the government. At its peak, this complex of boarding schools could hold nearly half of all Native American children at one time, a total of about 150,000 children ultimately attended these schools.
When the principal used to beat up the other children, like boys, the boys got the most beating. They used to call it bench party, and it was usually done after supper, and that's where I got frightened, because I saw blood.
These places were run like military schools, marching to meals, and the virtues of patriotism and obedience were instilled. Education was designed to serve an extreme assimilationist agenda, aiming to inculcate subservience to Western values, like private property and me first. Some were self-described industrial schools that focused on training, not education. The young women learned to become maids and household servants or to work in commercial laundries. The young men were taught the skills needed to work for ranchers and farmers or for factory, mine, and mill operators throughout the Western United States.
A devastating discovery has been made in Canada. The remains of 215 children have been found buried at the site of a former boarding school for Indigenous students.
Children were systematically found to be underfed and underweight. Together with forced labor, this caused staggering disease-driven mortality rates. Epidemics of deadly infectious diseases were common, including tuberculosis and at times smallpox. At the Carlisle Indian Industrial School in Pennsylvania, of the 73 Shoshone and Arapaho children enrolled between 1881 and 1894, only 26 survived. A 1908 study by the Smithsonian Institution found that overall only one in every five students was likely to be, quote, entirely free, end quote, of symptoms of tuberculosis.
And I can remember the principal grabbing a hold of me by the hand, you know, and I was jumping off the floor like that, and he stripped me. And he started whacking me with a long, webbed a strap. He was setting an example that, you know, if you do this, is what's going to happen to you. Like you. And all the other boys are watching. And you learn pretty quick after getting those kind of beatings. not strapping, it's literally beatings, you know. And ever since that day, I tried to run away.
Physical, emotional, and sexual abuse of the children by those who ran these schools was widespread. Many of the youngsters died trying to escape the schools and return to their reservations. Those who were captured and brought back to the schools were brutally beaten. In fact, brutal physical abuse, torture, was brought down on boys and girls alike for any number of violations.
So that was the start of my indoctrination, where they say, kill the Indian and the child. That's exactly what they were doing. Killing. When you left the residential school, it was very, very isolated incidents where people would go back and live on reserve. We were gone.
In 1910, the U.S. Indian Commissioner described their policy as, quote, a mighty pulverizing engine for breaking up the last vestiges of the tribal mass, end quote. Slaughter, disease, and forced assimilation. That is how you commit genocide.
All right, Sunsara, that brings us to the conclusion, to the end, almost, of episode number 175, our special Thanksgiving show in 2023.
That's right. Before we close out this 175th episode, two quick things. One, we want to ask everybody viewing, if you are not yet a patron of this show, if you do not yet financially support this show, please change that today. Sign up. We'll put the information on the screen, patreon.com/therevcoms. This is a community of people we want you to join that makes a monthly financial donation to our show. Everything we do here, the studio, the rent, the cameras, it depends on your support. And we need to grow this show. And we need your support to do that. Also, when you sign up and you become a Patreon, at whatever level fits your budget, you get special bonus content. You get early release content of some of what we put on the show. I mentioned earlier that I was in Chicago recently for the big screen showing of the Bob Avakian interviews. It was an incredible evening. I took questions from the audience. It was a very rich event. We are going to share with our patrons some of that question and answer that I did. We may put some of it on a future episode, but we will definitely share it with our Patreon. So sign up if you're not yet. The other thing we want to do to close out the show is share the wonderful news that recently came out that after many months in prison, the Iranian rapper Tumaj Salahi was released on bail. The International Emergency Campaign to Free Iran's Political Prisoners Now, or IEC, said this, quote, on November 18th, Tumaj walked out of Isfahan prison holding a bouquet of white roses after 386 days in detention, of which 252 days were in solitary confinement under horrific conditions of torture and isolation. To step back for a second, during the fall of 2022, a major uprising that lasted several months took place across Iran. We covered it on this show, and this uprising was initially sparked by the murder of Mahsa Jina Amini at the hands of the so-called morality police in Iran for not wearing her hijab, her headscarf, properly. This uncorked the fury and the anger and the hatred that so many women have pent up inside them, as well as men and people across the country from different ethnic groups, all ages and all walks of life, against the oppression of women and the regime as a whole of Iran, the Islamic fundamentalist regime there. And many artists came forward as part of this uprising and to support this struggle. And one of them was the rapper Tumaj, whose songs captured much of the defiance and the rebelliousness that we saw in the streets during the uprising. And for this, Tumaj was jailed. He was tortured. He suffered a broken leg, finger, fractured ribs, damage, severe damage to both of his eyes, denial of timely treatment for his injuries, and much more. So we'll be covering the continuing developments in Iran. We've been covering them at revcom.us. But today we want to close out the show and celebrate his release and salute his courage and the courage of all the political prisoners in Iran with an excerpt of one of his songs. So, Andy?
I want to thank the crew of the RNL show for their work on this show and every show. And I'm going to see you all in New York City on Tuesday. And you're going to see Sunsara back on the RNL show next week.
That's right. With that, here is Tumash.
از کشمیایم به راس هرم میزنیم شو میکنیم ببین چقدر دیدنی 44 سالتون سال شکست فجی اون روز همه داری دهن میپرید از کشمیایم به راس هرم میزنیم شو میکنیم ببین چقدر دیدنی 44 سالتون سال شکست فجی اون روز همه داری دهن میپرید ما نره ی خشمه هزار بی صداییم شورشی کمریشه ی انقلابی داریم عرب و آشوری ارمنی ترکمن مازنی سیستانی و بلوچ و تالش و تاتو آذری کرد و گیلک لور فارسی قشقایی ما اتحاد رودهاییم دریاییم ورزشکار و هنرمند دست فروش تا کاسب از محصل و معلم مهندس تا کارگر میکنیم کرگوش دیکتاتور و با ساز حق زن زندگی آزادی میجنگیم تا پای مرگ شونه به شونه پا به پا دیوار دفاعی باورم به هم بستگی مثل ایمان الهی مثل مسخ دین مثل مجنون بی باکسینه چاکی میران تومه مطیه این بیگانه ها نیست میدون جنگه از هر رنگی هستی بیا که بدون تو یه خونه لنگه میدون جنگه بیا که بخت تاختن تو دل دشمن بدون ترسه میدون جنگه